gameindustry.com. I'm Chella.
And I'm Drew, and together we're arguing about the things that really matter in games and films and stuff.
Indeed we are, and this is the last episode of 2017.
Oh yeah, we're finishing season 3, I didn't have to talk about that.
Our trilogy is complete.
So now, we're going on to the sequel trilogy now.
Yeah, the expanded universe, So, this week's topic, Drew?
Yeah, so we sort of hinted at this last week because we did the Totter Awards an episode early because there was a certain film coming out. I think everybody guessed that it was The Last Jedi, which is what we're talking about. Star Wars The Last Jedi, episode 8 of 9. Which we went to see on Saturday.
Friday.
Was it Friday?
Yeah.
Yes, it was. No, you're absolutely right. We went to see that on Friday.
It's going to be spoiler-free, largely, and then we will do a very clear spoiler warning. So if you haven't seen it, you can stick with us for a bit, and then we'll let you know when you should avert your ears.
Yes. Okay. So, I think, should we just jump straight into it?
Yep.
So, I mean, should we start with, like, overall impressions? Just, like, the one line, what did we think?
Yeah. Like, I mean, I think it's basically a grower, because when we came out, I was a bit like, I liked it, but, you know, there are some things, and I wasn't completely, like, super excited and everything. But then the more I've thought about it over these couple of days, the more I like it, and the more there is in there, and the more I want to see it again, because there's stuff I need to go back over.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, obviously we were talking about this before we recorded, but I'm in exactly the same boat. I think we both came out of it just sort of a little slightly underwhelmed and a little sort of confused about some of the aspects of it, not quite convinced. But then, like, as we've gone back on it and sort of thought about it and thought about what it was doing and what it was doing in relation to The Force Awakens, I think it's one that I'm going to have to see again, and it's going to be one I'm going to watch again when it comes out on Blu-ray. And I think when we get to the end of things, I'm going to look back on this one with sort of positive vibes.
Yeah, I think so. Think it is, because we came out saying, well, you know, it's a kind of, it's the middle one, but it's no Empire.
Yeah.
But I think in terms of tone, it kind of, it's and the sort of depth of stuff that's going on in there, it almost is the Empire of this trilogy. You know, depending what happens next, obviously.
I mean, it definitely sort of does directly reference Empire in a lot of the plot and a lot of the structure. Certainly it's doing this sort of, well, Empire is kind of two separate stories going on side by side. It's Luke and Yoda and then Han, Leia and the droids. This one is doing the same thing, but it's got a lot more to deal with, and it ends up sort of splitting into four different arcs.
Which
I think is kind of unavoidable in the way that the story that it's been left with is kind of structured. But it does make for a film that is kind of, that kind of goes on a bit too long, kind of has to do too much stuff.
Yeah.
Like, it's the longest Star Wars film by quite a way, I think.
It's about 2.5 hours or something, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah, it's long, and it did feel a bit long. There's a lot going on. But then, so I think that's part of the reason why we came away feeling a bit but then... underneath all the sort of convoluted plot and some of the sort of like dead ends and things that happen, there is actually a lot of Star Wars stuff happening that's quite interesting, and a lot of like really cool character stuff as well. That's like, it just feels like a bit more of a grown-up Star Wars in terms of character development.
But at the same time, in the bits that aren't story, I thought there were a lot of bits which were kind of, They felt sort of directly aimed at sort of children, and like, it kind of opens with that. There's we're gonna start discussing bits of the plot now, but the I don't know whether this is a spoiler or not. So it opens with a scene with one of the, like, Star Wars kind of always opens with a giant Imperial ship against a small rebel fighter or a small rebel ship. And in this one, it's kind of, so, you know, it opens with Poe facing down a giant ship in his X-Wing. And I thought, and what we sort of discussed about that afterwards is that it kind of doesn't make sense if you think about it too much. But it is a really cool thing for, like it's a really cool image for kids to see.
Yeah.
Because it's like the plucky sort of Han Solo-ish character, you know, doing something ridiculously, you know, heroic.
Yeah.
And even if it is, it, you kind of nitpick it afterwards, it is still just a cool...
Yeah, there were those cool Star Wars moments that we've kind of know and love as the, you know, people that grew up with the first trilogy are there, and I suppose they've kind of got to be there for the new generation who this could be their first Star Wars experience.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't know what kind of parent lets their child
The middle film, we'll go and see Attack of the Clones first. I think that's that's a good one to start with.
So should we kind of do an overview of the plot?
Again, we were discussing before the episode, this one's going to be a bit difficult to talk about because there are four different stories going on in them, and they're all kind of, there's crossover between all of them, but not a lot of it. Mm-hmm. And they do, it is sort of four separate films in one. So I guess we'll start with the storyline that was leads straight on from the end of Force Awakens, which is, you know, Luke and Rey on the Jedi steps on the island.
In Orkney or somewhere.
Which is, so, I mean, that's kind of the main headline for The Last Jedi is Luke is back. And I gotta say, Mark Hamill did a fantastic job. Whatever you think of the story, he is fantastic in this film.
Yeah,
I thought he
was
really good. Like, he nails a sort of older, grouchier Jedi master.
Yeah, he is. He's like one of the best Lukes he's ever been. He's really cool. Yeah, he's really good.
Yeah.
And he has some really good character stuff going on as well. I liked his bit. I wasn't. Are we getting into them one by one? The bit.
I think so. I think that's going to be the best way to do it. Otherwise, it's just going to be a mess.
Okay. So, with this, I've came away from this, one of the overwhelming things I felt when I came away from this is that Rey is the weakest link in this trilogy. I enjoyed her in the first one, but I think because this is like sort of weightier story stuff, I just felt that her performance just didn't carry it very well. Like the scenes between her and Luke, I don't know what it was. She was just wasn't delivering some of the lines with the impact I wanted. I just felt she was a bit weak.
She
didn't feel like the hero I wanted her to be.
I really liked her in The Force Awakens. I don't think she... I wouldn't call her the weak link in the trilogy, but I certainly think she's the one who gets the least to do in this film, and what she does get, she doesn't do anything stunning with. She's kind of there. She's kind of the hero. She gets some kind of good scenes with Luke, but she's... Most of her scenes are about Luke rather than about her. There is... she does have a really good scene quite early on, I think, where she is... being sort of trained in the Force by Luke, this is the first sort of third of the film, and it's probably like the best meditation on the nature of the Force and what the Force actually is in the films. Like they actually kind of go into detail about how it kind of works, what it is, and it's done with this really cool kind of cinematography, which you would not find in any of the previous Star Wars films. It's very modern, cutting back and forth techniques, which are kind of new to Star Wars, and it was something that was brought in The Force Awakens as well, but it works really well here. But again, that's not really about her. She's just kind of sitting there having it happen to her. Mm-hmm. She's kind of a very passive character in this one.
Yeah, she is. And yeah, I just felt, and she was also the sort of exposition character, She was just like, oh, but you need to come and help us because this is happening and, you know, blah, 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 just mm-hmm. in case, like,
anyone
audience
had forgotten,
note.
yeah.
Yeah, exactly. And, yeah, so I just felt some of the dialogue wasn't great. And then, like you say, what she was given, what little she was given, I just mm-hmm. didn't feel she did the best with it.
No.
And, yeah, I think I said this to you afterwards. I actually prefer the actress from Rogue One. I find her more charismatic than Daisy Ridley. But, you know, we've got Daisy Ridley, so that's what we got. There's nothing I can do about that. Hopefully she'll, yeah, bring it back in the next one.
I mean, presumably she'll be given more to do because, you know, the film itself does set her up as being, like, it says quite specifically that she is important, that she and Ren are both important. I think that was something that was sort of hinted at in The Force Awakens, is that they're kind of two sides of the same coin and they're connected in a very specific way through mm-hmm. the Force. So yeah. It would be strange if that didn't pay off at the end.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
But yeah. She certainly doesn't get too much to do in this film.
No. Because, I mean, if you think about, because this is basically Luke going to find Yoda, and this is that basically, but with Rey and Luke. And if you think about, like, Luke's performance, or, you know, in that film, I just felt she wasn't a patch. She just didn't. She was very passive, and you just didn't feel like anything kind of affected her really.
Yeah. Do you think that's
considering she's like grappling with like these huge things, you know, it's like the force of the universe flowing through her, and like some of it is dark and dangerous, and her this master that she's gone to find is scared about it, and she's just like
I mean, do you think that's maybe sort of a function of the fact that there is so much to pack into this film? Because, like, if we did go through that, there's not much she could do that would be different from what Luke had on Dagobah. It's still going to be just her kind of sitting there levitating rocks with her mind.
Which they explicitly say, like, that's not what the Force is all about.
Like, that's very good.
It's time, probably. But there is a really cool scene. I mean, not going to describe it or anything, but there is some really cool, this cool moment where she sort of goes into a cave and, you know, has some realization moment.
Yeah.
And it is just, it's really cool. It's not something we've seen in Star Wars before, the way it's shot. And it's just very Rian Johnson style thing. Yeah. You could just feel his kind of autograph on the film with that scene, and I loved that because I love him as a director, so that was cool.
You sort of said it's something we haven't seen in Star Wars before. Like, what I liked about it was that it, in the same way that The Force Awakens sort of remake New Hope, this is something that we've seen before. Luke goes into the cave and he has this hallucinatory sequence in Empire Strikes Back, but it's remixed, it's redone, it does something else, and it's just it becomes brand new because of it.
Exactly. Yeah, the scene is the same, but the way it's done is like brilliantly different. Because, you know, we have all the iconic sort of screen wipe stuff and things like that, and he's bringing something new, some new visual language to the Star Wars, which is great. And of course, we can't forget the porgs. This is where they're introduced.
Yeah.
And they're not Jar Jar things.
No, they're not. No, that is good at least. I watched the trailer, and so like it's just the one shot of a porg in there, I think, isn't it? And he's sitting in the sort of seat in the Falcon, and I looked at that and I thought, ah, I'm being sold a cuddly toy. They're not. They're actually kind of they're interesting. I think they appear a couple of times too often through the film, but they don't really wear out their welcome, and I like them more than I was expecting to.
They're not Scrappy Doo either.
No.
Because that was the, like, oh god.
Yeah, because I think that's what I thought from the trailer, is that this is a new sidekick character. But no, they're just, like, they're gremlins, basically.
They're just little critters. They were good fun. I liked them. So, next bit of plot. I think I'm done with Luke and Rey.
I'm done with them. Don't need any more of those characters, thank you very much. I think the next sort of in order of sort of importance to the plot, I think the next one is probably Rose and Finn's plot.
Mm-hmm.
So Rose, yeah, if you haven't seen it yet, you probably won't know who Rose is. Mm-hmm. I had no idea that she was a character in this film until I saw it, and she's introduced quite early on. Mm-hmm. And yeah, she's a fantastic new addition to Star Wars.
Yeah, I think she is. Yeah,
Really liked her as a main character.
Mm-hmm. I thought she was going to have a big role because everyone was so excited about having an Asian lead.
Yeah.
I think she's of Vietnamese heritage. Mm-hmm.
As characters, they get what's kind of equivalent to the Bespin and Cloud City plot in Empire Strikes Back,
mm-hmm.
In that they're kind of so we should kind of talk about the main sort of plot premise of the film because I think
the next bit is to talk about like the Leia and the ship and the rebels basically and where they are. You're good at these, sir.
Oh shit, am I? The film kind of opened in the same place that Empire Strikes Back opened. It's the last holdout of the Resistance as they were on Hoth, and suddenly the Imperial fleet descends on them, and they have to sort of leg it out into the galaxy. And when that started, I thought, okay, this is just retreading Empire Strikes Back pretty directly, but it only lasts... It's not a long scene. It's certainly not as long as the Hoth opening. And soon enough, they're being chased across the galaxy by the First Order fleet. I should stop saying the Empire.
Yeah.
Even though they are just the Empire.
Yeah, they really are.
And that's kind of where the whole film takes place. It's this long, protracted chase across the galaxy.
Makes it sound more exciting than it is.
Yeah, it kind of does. It's a premise that when I saw it in the film, I thought, oh, this is kind of a Mad Max thing. It's going to be one long chase from one side of the galaxy to the other, which it is, but the film never makes a lot of that. It just kind of functions as a timer. Like, the Resistance able to stay just ahead of the First Order fleet for the entire film. They're just out of range of the whole thing, and the big danger is that soon they're going to run out of fuel. And what that achieves in the sort of plot terms is that every so often it will cut back to this plot and they will say, oh, we've only got 12 hours left till we run out of fuel, and then they'll go off to do another plot and then they'll come back and now, oh no, we've only got six hours left now, and one of our ships is gone, but everyone's fine, we're just kind of keeping going. It's
kind of like filming a car chase with mm-hmm. two cruise ships.
Yes, basically that's exactly what it is.
Yeah. It's like really slow.
And the thing is, that can be done really well, and that's been done before in sort of other media. Like, there's a really good original Star Trek episode which is about that. There's Balance of Terror, which is the kind of submarines in a nebula sort of thing, mm-hmm. where it's very tense and it's very. But yeah, this doesn't really sort of.
There isn't any tension really.
No,
in
there
that
isn't.
Sort of countdown at all. No. Yeah, there's lots of standing around. Like, the villains stand around in really shiny black places.
Yes.
Looking out of windows and saying destroy them and clenching their fists, and then the goodies stand in sort of white rooms mm-hmm. with sort of like turquoise lights on plastic things,
just kind of reassuring each other. Fine, we'll just keep on, we've got the hope of the Resistance, we'll do that, we're fine.
So that's the sort of linchpin for all these other four stories, is basically Rey trying to get Luke to engage with the Resistance and the fight again,
mm-hmm.
and Finn and Rose have a mission that mm-hmm. is to help them, kind of give them the final advantage.
They need to escape this chase.
Yeah.
So we can, now that we've explained that, we can kind of go back to what Rose and Finn actually end up doing. They kind of end up going to this strange alien city, which is, it's Cloud City turned up to 11. It's all kind of casinos, it's all very rich, it's the aristocracy, and there's a lot going on.
Kind of Monte Carlo in space.
Yes, no, absolutely, yeah, that's exactly what I was thinking. It's a really nice area. It was one of my favourite sort of locations in the film.
Yeah. Yeah, I loved it. I wanted to stay there. I wanted more time there because it was really rich with this is the sort of cantina scene, but like the other end of the social spectrum.
Yeah,
So like
absolutely.
rich with aliens and really exotic looking drinks and food and stuff, and they're playing games and there's music and it's all kind of cotton club kind of feel to it, and yeah, just lavish. Yeah, they must have spent a lot of money on that really short sequence, and I just wanted to stay there.
No, absolutely. And of course, in the context of the film, like she, you see this very pretty city, and then later on, the characters are like, well, actually, this place isn't so great. It's, you know, this is being done on the backs of the disenfranchised. And I was like, okay, yeah, but I still want to kind of see more of it. Can we go and do, can we do it, go and do the rich stuff again?
So Rose is basically the sort of working class hero, I guess.
Yeah, she is.
She's the Is she an engineer or
Yeah,
something
she's
like
I mean,
that? Some sort of technician, isn't she? She's
she's
supposed to.
mechanically inclined, certainly. And she kind of establishes herself very very early on as being a sort of you know, self-driven kind of actiony character. She does something very early where it kind of fakes you out into thinking she's going to be kind of this passive kind of mopey character, and then she doesn't. She turns around, she says, no, you look, without spoiling what actually happens, because it's such a cool moment, I think. But she, and like, that's something that I thought was sort of evident throughout this film, is that there was, apart from kind of Rey explaining like the plot of the previous film, there was no, everything was done through action rather than exposition, like, which is again such a refreshing change from what was in the prequel trilogies, where it was all just people standing around explaining like trade routes and taxation. All of the plot advance, all of the plot development in this film is done through character action rather than, you know, background and dialogue. And
It is. And she is a really great character. She's just like bright and kind of cheery and and sort of plucky. She is like the ultimate sort of plucky sort of working class hero who, she's not one of the big flashy heroes. She's like, oh, you're Finn, and she's like in awe of everybody and everything. And it's really behind the rebellion, she's who they're doing it for kind of thing. She's a great character. I thought she was really cool.
And that's kind of the great, the scene that sort of establishes her, is that she is kind of starstruck by Finn, but she's not naive. As soon as she kind of realizes that he's maybe not the like upstanding hero that she's expecting, she turns on him straight away. She figures him out. It's really, really good. And she kind of continues that throughout the whole film, and it never gets to the point where she becomes the sort of scrappy do character. She's not too plucky, she's not too upbeat and annoying.
Looking forward to seeing more of her.
Yeah.
Definitely. Yeah, and I think especially in contrast to Rey, I just find her way more interesting.
I mean, that's kind of always been the problem with the Jedi, hasn't it? Because like, even Luke in Empire and Jedi, he's kind of the least interesting one. He is a bit
Yeah, that's
pious, he's a
true.
bit sort of he's a bit kind of aloof and above everything. He's still a
Sort of
great character, but
earnest.
But he is the hero around which everyone else is structured.
Yeah, the sort of chosen one type thing. Yeah. Guess with Rose and Finn, we have two other characters, one new and one returning.
So yeah,
Returning.
which one will we start with?
Well, I guess if we're on the casino planet, then the Benicio del Toro character.
So to just give some background about what that is, they are sent to look for this roguish, brilliant codebreaker character who is also a poet with a blaster, and like, he's described as this very sort of, you know, roguish, fun character. And one of the like things I like I straight up don't like about this film is that they are definitely deliberately trying to make you think it's Lando. They don't name that character. There's no reason not to give him a name other than to make you think, oh, it's someone we've seen before.
Right, yeah.
And like they kind of it kind of directly builds you up to it being Lando, and then it's kind of not Lando, and Lando is not mentioned. Lando is not in the film. So I was...
That's so sad.
Yeah, it really is, because as soon as I thought, oh, I figured out who that is, I was like, oh, yes, that's brilliant. I can't wait for him to show up.
Yeah, and it's like, then we see the planet. It's like, oh, this is such a Lando
this
planet.
This is Lando planet, yeah.
Yeah, Lando planet.
Exactly.
Like, everything's cream and gold. He's all over this. He's got his, like, one-shoulder affair going on.
Yeah, and then it's just, like...
Not.
It's just not. And that's all there is. There's no, oh, it's not Lando. It's just he's not mentioned. All right. So the guy they do actually eventually find is this completely new character called DJ, played by Benicio del Toro, and he's kind of really good. And it's difficult to say much about him in terms of plot, because there's not a deep plot to him, but what is there is kind of spoilery, and you'll want to see it for yourself.
He's good. He's just Benicio del Toro doing his thing really well. And then the other character is, well, it's kind of a completely useless character, I think. It's the Gwendolyn Christie character.
Oh, yeah.
What's it?
Captain Phasma.
Oh, my God. That is just the... Who? they still have their job, whoever came up with that name?
Okay, come on. This is going to be a J.J. Abrams thing, isn't it? She returns spoilers she does show up, and she's kind of like, she's always been kind of Finn's like sort of semi-arch nemesis. She's never been a big character in it. She's always been kind of the lieutenant. She's the Admiral Pietro, the Captain Nita character, only she gets a little bit more to do. And
They could have easily just like cut her, and it wouldn't have done anything at all.
I mean, yeah, they kind of have to have her somewhere, because she is sort of specifically at the end of The Force Awakens, she's left alive, and like she's shown to be kind of vengeful and angry at Finn. So they had to bring her back somewhere. I don't know if they needed to bring her back in this film. She could have just been a sort of smaller part in whatever the next one is called. What's that? They do have kind of a good sort of conflict between them, and like, as evil characters go, you may as well put her in a role somewhere than just having some random Imperial guy.
I mean, she looks cool, and that's pretty much it.
Yeah. Like, she is shiny, which is cool.
Yeah, she's very shiny.
But yeah, it feels like, and again, we were talking about this earlier, it feels like a lot of The Last Jedi is kind of just sort of tying off loose ends from The Force Awakens that didn't really need to be there. Like, because the thing about J.J. Abrams' films is that he likes to set up mysteries, and then he doesn't like to resolve them. Like, he's come out and said that's specifically his thing. He likes mystery boxes, which you never know what's inside them. It's part of his kind of... Like, he does that purposefully. That's where Lost came from. That's where a lot of his stuff comes from. But I think certainly in a Star Wars film, and Star Wars film being sort of famously tightly structured, like they're based very, very solidly on Joseph Campbell's Hero's Journey mythology. They were written specifically to that. The whole point of that is that they close off at the end. Like, I don't think that an unanswered mystery is particularly suited to Star Wars. It's not suited to adventures.
For ambiguity.
No, it's not a mystery series.
No, it's mythology, you know, so you need satisfying endings and sort of journeys for your characters and stuff like that.
And we can't really talk about all of the ones that it does cut off without spoiling, because it does end quite a few plot lines here, but there's definitely at least 3 or 4 occasions where it feels like, okay, we're just going to put a plug in this now, because it's not important to the main story. We'll just and we'll carry on with the important stuff.
Back to Leia. We've only got 6 more hours.
And yeah, I think that's kind of what's happening with Captain Phasma in this one. It's kind of, they wanted to close off her story, like the storyline that she began in The Force Awakens.
Yeah, yeah. It's just kind of needless. Yeah. So, the next section is, well, we've got Poe and Leia and Holdo, and we've also got Kylo Ren, who's kind of out on his own, sort of lost in the miasma of the Force swirling around and through him.
I've got to say, I think Kylo Ren, like Adam Driver, like the character, the plot, I think they were kind of the strongest thing in this film for me. I thought they did a really good job developing him.
Yeah, I think so too. Yeah, you kind of talked me round a bit. The trouble is with him, okay, I have, because I partly agree, but part of the trouble is being the young villain, a villain who is young, you always will err into this sort of stroppy teenager kind of feel. And he has a bit of that sometimes. Sometimes he gets a bit pouty. And, okay, I'm willing to forgive that. But the one thing that I just can't get is like, okay, so I have to be careful not to spoil it. So they do go into the backstory of, like, how he sort of went towards the dark side and everything and how that links in. And I get that, and it's kind of a cool motivation. My only thing is, it's like, I think it's a really big leap from that motivation when he was young and training to now I want to take over the universe and be this like dark overlord. You know, it's like there's no kind of stages of which, even for all its faults, the first trilogy, 1, 2, 3,
the prequel trilogy,
because that's all about his journey. So I suppose they have more time and space to focus on him going from annoying to like different grade of annoying, but he does go through loads of trauma with, you know, like losing his parents, and then, you know, he has this love affair, and then he loses her, and then, you know, and all these like horrible things happen. He gets his legs cut off and whatever, but there's none of this with Kylo Ren. He's just kind of jumped straight to, you know what, I'm just going to start my own empire and become a fascist dictator.
I think that is kind of like, they do touch on what drove him to that. It's not done through like character, but there is a kind of slightly hand-wavy explanation that he is, like, in the same way that Rey is much stronger than Jedi we've seen in the past, he being the opposite side of the coin, he is kind of, like, he's darker and more predisposed to evil than previous villains, than Darth Vader, for example. Like, just Rey and Ren, they seem to be, like, just amped-up versions of Luke and Vader.
Yeah.
If you see what I mean. It's it's taking that basic character and then just putting a lot of force power behind them and kind of seeing what happens in the story.
Yeah, I guess it is. It's just that. It's just like, oh, he's just got a lot of force.
But so yeah. Like, it is disappointing because it doesn't feel human. It feels like, oh, it's just magic doing this for the sake of, like, plot.
Yeah. I think there is a bit of that. But that said, like you say, it is the most interesting, but his inner conflict is interesting and kind of subverts the usual Star Wars.
Yeah, it's like he is a dark side Jedi who constantly feels like the pull of the light, which is really interesting.
Yeah, it is.
And yeah, and with, again, without spoiling too much about where he goes, he gets some really good villainous moments in this, I think. And
he does.
When he is being full-on villain mode, he is fantastic. And he was in The Force Awakens as well. He's really good at doing that just violent anger where he kind of just starts smashing things into the wall. And he's, like, just unrestrained rage. Mm-hmm. And in this film, you get to see him do it with his mask off, which is really cool. Because in the film, you don't see the expressions he's making. When you actually do in this film, he's, like, he pulls them off really well. It doesn't look silly. Yeah. It doesn't look forced.
No, that's true. That's true. And he is a huge guy as well.
He's
like physically imposing. Yeah, he's pretty cool. Casting there. Yeah. Yeah, I'm looking forward to him in the next one, what they're gonna do with that. Definitely more than Rey. I know I'm kind of down on Rey, but yeah.
Yeah. I mean, I, yeah,
he's
I,
more
like,
interesting.
I think he is the more interesting part of that duo, yeah. But,
yeah.
But they are kind of predicated on being the opposites
they need
of each
other.
They
need
yeah.
each other, yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah, yeah. So it's Kylo and
the last sort of storyline is the main sort of car chase one, the spaceship chase, which is all sort of predicated around Poe, Leia, and this new character played by Laura Dern called Admiral Holdo, is it?
Vice Admiral Holdo.
Vice Admiral Holdo.
Yeah.
Who is, I don't know how detailed we want to get discussing this plot, because...
No, it's difficult without spoilering. Mm. It's basically, it's Poe's character arc, and it's him, like, learning to be a leader rather than a hothead, like, hotshot flyboy, basically. That's the arc we're trying to get, and Leia is, like, the woman who shapes him, and then also Laura Dern's character also becomes part of that.
Yes.
So yeah, and it's really, I quite liked it, and and I really liked the Laura Dern character. She looked amazing.
She really did. She had great hair. She looked just fantastic. The outfit was fantastic.
The dress was just like one of the best Star Wars dresses there's ever been. Yeah. It was amazing. I was just like, oh my god, people are going to cosplay the shit
yeah,
out of
no,
that.
Absolutely. She's a really good character. I don't know if she's a fantastic character. She's certainly an interesting one and a visually fantastic one.
Yeah, she's iconic, like instantly iconic. I did like her as a character. I felt like, I thought it was cool that she was this, military hero, who'd done these amazing battles, and, her reputation preceded her, and she was like really strong. I felt she was a more convincing military leader than Leia.
She certainly was.
She was just like badass. As soon as she stepped in, she was just like, I'm not taking any of your shit, boy. You just like step back, because I've seen it all.
Like, she made a very good, like, solid wall of a character for Poe to run up against. He's got all this sort of anger, he's got all this, he wants to hop in an X-Wing and blow something up, which is the line that they sort of repeatedly come back to in the film. She has none of it. She gives him no quarter at all.
Yeah.
And it's a really interesting character relationship, but again, without spoiling anything, the way that arc goes, I didn't believe it at the end. I didn't understand why those characters acted the way they did.
No. Yeah. That's all we can say.
Yeah, we're coming to the spoiler wall anyway pretty soon, I think.
Yeah, I think so. So otherwise, we're going to be running super long anyway.
We have lost I've lost my window. Oh, yes, we are.
Do we want to drop a spoiler wall?
Yeah, I think we will. From here on out, we're going to sort of... talk specific plot details. If you don't want to hear those, stop listening now, and you can get in touch with us on Twitter, and should we do the ending spiel? Why don't you drop some comments about what you've listened to so far in and you can do that on Twitter at ArgueTheCast. You can do it on GameIndustry.com in the podcast section under ArgueTheToss. Where else is there?
All the social media places. We're everywhere.
Yeah, we're everywhere. You listen to another episode. We go into it in full detail. So, with that in mind, with that out of the way, I mean to say.
Yeah.
Spoiler time.
Yeah.
Okay. So the resolution of that sort of Poe or Holdo sort of storyline is that it turns out they had Holdo seems like she's dooming the rebellion through inaction, and that's what sort of gets to Poe, and Poe kind of mutinies and takes over to enact his own plan. And then it kind of turned out at the very, very end that Holdo had another plan all along that would keep the rebellion safe and, you know, buy them some more time than Poe's plan was going to be able to. I didn't understand why they didn't just take Poe aside and say, yeah, this is what we're doing. This is why we're doing this. And that would have kind of diffused the whole thing. It's kind of a story that doesn't make sense to me if the characters act like real characters.
I think there was quite a bit of that. Because, I mean, the only thing I could think is they'd have to let the audience in on it and have Laura Dern and Carrie Fisher have a conversation where they say something like, well, we can't tell him because he's gone against orders time and time again, and so if we tell him, he's going to jeopardize this mission, so we're going to have to, like, it's on a need to know, and he just does not need to know, and so they'd have to let us in on it, but they seem to want it to be like this big plot twist, but it doesn't work as that, because them all look like, why did you do that?
If you can't make it work without letting the audience know, then maybe you kind of need to scrap it and come up with another storyline in that plot.
If you want a plot twist. I mean, I think it's fine to let the audience know, because then you're kind of going, oh, shit, Poe's doing all this stuff and he doesn't know he's jeopardizing, and it adds a new tension.
Before you find out what that twist is, that's a really great arc, that mutiny. It's really interesting to watch Poe sort of be driven to something that you wouldn't think he'd normally do. But when it's all resolved, it's like, okay, well, that didn't actually need to happen at all.
And I suppose the key part of that section is the Leia coma we're going full spoiler now, so I suppose I can say, you know, like, Leia dies, floats it out into space, and then kind of
revives herself.
Using the Force. I don't
think she's meant to have revived herself. She's not quite dead when it happens, but she's blown out into space, and then just kind of uses the Force
kill most people, is what I mean.
She's
been blasted out of a spaceship into the cold darkness of space. Most people would be dead.
But she kind of just she uses Force powers, which we haven't really seen her use before, to just kind of guide herself back to an airlock and back into the ship.
And nobody seems particularly like, holy fuck. They see her float through space all the time, kind of thing.
Like, she uses that as a shortcut to get from one area of the ship to the other sometimes. It's not fine.
It was... Because all the way through this, I thought Leia was going to die, because obviously we've lost Carrie Fisher. Mm-hmm. And I had tissues ready, because I was like, it's going to be awful. I don't want to say goodbye to her.
No.
And I was like, okay, this is it. And I was like, oh, this is actually quite nice. Way for her to go, and she looked kind of angelic, and she was kind of frosted over, and I was like, oh, her fingers are moving, and then she came back to life, and I was like, oh god, okay, weird, why would you do that to her?
I was under the assumption that she wasn't going to die, because when Carrie Fisher did pass away, there was, like, Disney came out and said, yes, we've gone into crisis, we're discussing what we're going to do, we're not going to change the film. That's what they said, basically. We're not going to change the film as written. And it was difficult to tell whether they were just, you know, being vague and non-specific to say, well, they were supposed to die in this film anyway, which it turns out is not the case.
Yeah.
But, that's kind of what happens. There is no sort of send-off for Carrie Fisher. She ends the film in the same sort of dramatic circumstances as any other character in the film. There's no special attention paid to her.
No.
So, yeah, I wonder what they're going to do to bring it to... You know, write her out of episode 9.
Yeah,
I'm sure they'll find a way.
It's going to be sad anyway, So that was part of this new... there was the her death, and then so subsequently she goes into a coma, which allows Laura Dern's Carol Holdo to then assume command and go head to head, toe to toe with Poe. But I think they just didn't need that death.
No.
They could have just still had Laura Dern being, because she's obviously the second to, you know, General Organa. And so they could have just had her there, you know, just backing Leia up and going to having those scenes anyway.
Yeah, I think what did it, like, if they'd had Leia there, there would have been no reason for her not to explain to Poe. I guess that's how they're justifying it, is that Laura Dern's character specifically doesn't trust Poe. When she's actually like, oh, it is just captain, isn't it? You have been demoted.
Yeah.
She's kind of very dismissive of him.
Yeah.
But she should kind of know that he's, you know, like, he's the equivalent of Leia's son in this one. Like, they have a very sort of maternal and son-ternal relationship. Wait, what's... is there a word that I'm just blanking on?
Yeah, I've blanked it,
Fair enough. But they have a kind of mother and son relationship. And you'd think that Holdo would...
Is it filial?
Oh, yeah. No, kind of, maybe.
Is that brother?
No, I think that's parenthood in general. Like, no, yeah.
Anyway. I digress.
Yeah, okay, yeah. Edit that out. we digressed,
sorry,
and I forgot where we were.
So they have that.
Yeah, they do. It feels like Holdo should have been more trusting of Poe than she was if she was that close to Leia. Because he is kind of like the Resistance's mascot, almost.
Yeah.
You know, he is the front man. Everyone knows who Poe Dameron is.
I don't know. It was weird. And then the fact that Laura Dern apparently dies, I'm gutted.
Yeah, it would have been nice to see her in the third one.
Yeah, because she's just so, like, it's so weird that they've made all this amazing, cool stuff like that casino, you know, Lando planet, and this amazing, iconic kind of female military hero who, you know, just when, you know, Leia has to, you know, has to leave in whatever way they decide.
Yeah.
She would be a great character to, like, have in there.
Yeah, and absolutely.
They've just, like, killed... I was just like, okay, yeah. So I was really sad about that. So the Force, the other thing, I suppose this kind of last thing to discuss is the new Force elements.
I think the thing where we were most sort of taken off guard by is that Luke shows the ability to sort of broadcast a hologram of himself from one planet to another planet, in kind of real time, using the Force, which is something that
so convincingly that people can talk face to face with him.
Like, not even that,
not know.
He picks up a lightsaber and fights with it. Like, he has a probably it's an extension of the Force that we haven't seen before, and while there are moments in previous films where that has happened, for example, Rey has shown powers that that we haven't seen in previous films in The Force Awakens. I can't remember specifically what it was, but I remember we've had this sort of discussion before. Like, this seemed like a big
leap.
Yeah, like this, and I guess it's because Luke's been kind of trapped on an island just meditating on the Force for years and years, and he's become much more powerful than anyone we've seen before. But it still felt like it was overreaching the rules of the Force.
Yeah, and it kind of, but for story, it's, you know, it felt a bit Deus Ex Machina.
Yeah, no, absolutely.
Yeah, which is a shame, because it's just, you really don't want to go there with Star Wars and the Force, because the Force is already this kind of like, it's this thing, and it flows around, and we can do all this stuff. And so if you start just, like, plucking out stuff like this, where he can, you know, project and have a physical effect as well. So, you know, he gives something to Leia, and it actually drops into her hand. And it's just, so...
And I guess, like, it does... In the film, he does pay the price for it. But I mean, I think that's the point of his death at the end, is that he has exerted him, like, he's used everything he had to do this.
So I
suppose that goes some way towards making it a bit more okay.
Balancing it,
yeah.
But it does leave it open for now other characters to do that.
Once one character can do it, then there's no tension in any of the other scenes, because it could always just be someone
doing a hologram.
What was the film we were talking about the other week where we were saying the exact same thing, where a character dies and comes back?
I've
forgotten.
Justice
League. Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Once you're able to revive a character, once a character is able to do something so... that affects things so significantly, then now anyone can do it.
Yeah, exactly. It becomes sort of like nobody really dies and people are kind of impervious because it's like, oh, it's just a hologram, or
revive
them.
Yeah, it's a superpower that could be used in so many different applications that it's going to make it difficult to trust anything that happens in the subsequent film.
The other thing is,
midway through this film, Yoda's ghost sort of appears to Luke and they have a discussion. And Yoda is also able to affect the physical world. He causes lightning to strike a tree. And is Luke going to be able to do that now? Is Luke going to be able to come back as a ghost and use force powers?
Yeah, fight. That would, like, sort of imply that they could actually come into battle. That means we could have all the Jedi Masters ever come back into battle use lightning.
No, that's absolutely going to be it. That's the last scene of Episode 9. Like, Hayden Christensen as a force hologram doing all his spinny lightsaber tricks.
So
it kind of sort of sets up the idea that death isn't the end, which it never has been in Star Wars, I guess. Ben came back and talked to Luke. Yoda, comes back at the end of Return of the Jedi. But it always did feel like, even given the death is the end of those characters being able to interfere with what's happening.
They're just there. They have a presence. They can, sort of look on. Like guardian angels basically. They can't actually do anything. But now, which then means, like, Vader can come back. The Emperor can come back.
No, it's going to be it's going to be like Civil War. It's going to be all of the Avengers get together in a spaceport for one just massive scrap. Hope it's not that. That's my overall impression of The Last Jedi, and I hope that that doesn't happen.
I guess what our hopes for the next film is probably our closing thoughts thing. So we were discussing that as well.
So I guess my main hope is that they get somebody else to direct it.
I didn't know that. It was still up in the air who's directing.
But apparently it's J.J. Abrams directing and co-writing, and J.J. Abrams not got the best record on ending stories. He's good at setting up mysteries, but setting up mysteries is very easy. It's the satisfying resolution that is the hard part.
The hard part, basically. Yeah. I liked the things that Rian Johnson has started with this film. And like I've said about 3 or 4 times already, I love his films.
Yeah.
They're just great. And so I really want him to see him finish this, because he was kind of handed over a bit of a mess. And he's had this really difficult job of, putting this middle thing together. And he's brought in some, like, cool elements and stuff, and laid down some really cool character stuff. And so it'd be really nice to see him be able to finish that. But, we're not getting that. And it's kind of weird that J.J. Abrams is kind of sandwiching this thing. So he's kind of tied off some plot points that J.J. Abrams set up. And then what's J.J. Abrams going to do? It's just a bit of a weird sandwich of kind of visions, basically. But it is what it is. I just hope they've got a good ending. Oh, God.
Yeah. And if not, I guess we'll just have to wait for... Rian Johnson's, I keep calling him Rian, it's spelt Rian, it's Rian Johnson, his own Star Wars trilogy, which he's apparently getting to do.
Is he?
Yeah. Did you not hear about this?
I don't really keep up with all the gossip because it just gives me Star Wars fatigue.
Oh, fair enough. Yeah.
I just like to look forward to them when...
I mean, that was my reaction when I heard this news, but he's getting his own trilogy, his own spin-off trilogy, which is going to be set in a different galaxy with completely different characters.
Which
I don't know why they need to call that Star Wars, but I'm just not...
Money.
Yeah, exactly. Just need to let him do his own thing, but that's the next step in Star Wars, I think.
Oh, so he's gone off to do that. Oh, yeah, maybe he's like, you know what, I don't want to do this third no. one of this, like, so can I, I've just got this cool story idea, and they were like, okay, do that, yeah. Cause I think he could do a good job, because, I mean, I love Looper. I think it's one of the best time travel films ever. It's brilliant. Mm-hmm. And I think he could do some interesting stuff. And that cool scene with Rey in the cave was just, really,
it was
loved
fun,
it. Yeah, sort of classy, stylish. So, this has been a long one.
It has, and we kind of started rambling at the end, I think. Shall we wrap it up? Oh, Christ, we've nearly gone to an hour,
I know. Well, the film is 2.5 hours, so there was... And I think it kind of indicates how much there is going on in this. There is a lot of stuff going on. I think it will hold up to further watches.
Yeah. I mean, I'm probably going to go and see it again in a couple of weeks and see what I think of it then. But I'm interested to see what it's like on a second watch.
Yeah. Force Awakens is on Netflix now, so I might actually watch that and see that kind of help cement things, see what... Because I've forgotten a lot of that.
Yeah, I meant to watch it before I went to see The Last Jedi, and I ended up just not bothering.
So, on the whole, I think it's a grower.
Yeah, I liked it. There were some bits I was confused and underwhelmed by, but on reflection, they kind of worked better than I thought they did in the moment.
Yeah.
But, I'm looking forward to seeing what the consensus on it is in a year's time.
I'm just looking forward to getting to the end, just to, like, there's this feel, just want to feel, I don't know, it just doesn't feel complete.
we need closure.
None of them have been quite as satisfying as A New Hope or Empire.
No.
So
I mean, I got quite a lot out of The Force Awakens, I think, in terms of, feeling like I was watching Star Wars again.
You really liked that, didn't you?
I did, and I didn't get that sort of emotional punch out of this film, but...
We'll see. But it's not disappointing.
No.
Star Wars fans don't need to worry, I don't think, that they've done anything terrible or anything. There's some good stuff, and it still looks awesome.
Absolutely.
Yeah, it's like really nice and like cool character stuff.
Good. So if you're a Star Wars fan, we do recommend that you go and see Star Wars Episode 8.
just in case, like, what Star Wars fan would be like, you know what?
I'm going to skip this one.
I'm going to skip this one and just wait for the Han Solo spin-off one.
Alright, I think we better wrap it up there.
We have, and I guess we should say Merry Festivities, whatever it is.
Merry whatever and a Happy New Year.
And a Happy New Year, and we will see you for Season 4.
Yeah.
A new trilogy begins.
Are we going prequel or sequel for this one?
Okay. So,
That's me.
Till next time, Drew.
Cheerio.